When it comes to futuristic icons, not a lot of cars can pass Dome Zero. Probably, like many of you, I learned about Dome Zero from Gran Turismo 4, and together with Gizeta, Dome was the car that I remembered most. But since I'm a terrible gamer, I never managed to unlock the cars. But Dome wasn't just a good looking car, but also a great performance car, which could go against some of the Euro exotics of the time. But the thing that made Dome so special is that it came at a time when established Japanese brands were only building budget cars. And here came Dome, out of nowhere, with a mid-engine supercar. So hello guys and welcome back to another video. And here is the story of Dome Zero. The year was 1975, when Japanese businessman and racing driver Minoru Hayashi decided to create his own car company. A car like no other Japanese car before. But the story of Hayashi and Dome begins since the mid-60s, when in 1965 Minoru, together with Tojiro Ukiya, built a racing car based on the Honda S600. Tojiro wanted a racing S600, and he wanted to have better aerodynamics. And this would be done by converting the beautiful body into aerodynamic coupe. The problem was that the roof on top of the S600 would just add more weight. So he turned to Hayashi, which was a specialist of the new technology, fiber-reinforced plastic. The 20-year-old Hayashi turned up with a quite brutal body, but which did his job pretty well. 1 year later, in 1966, Hayashi built another racing car, based on the newly introduced Honda S800. Differently from the coupe body of the first car, the S800 was rebodied with a more streamlined body. But Hayashi didn't stop here, since he also supercharged the car. The S800 body proved to be quite popular, since teams and private drivers bought these bodies for their own cars. Minoru continued building different racing cars and parts for them. But in 1975, he finally decided to build his dream car. Which, by the way, Dome means Kabushiki Kaisha Domo, which translates to child's dream. He wanted to build a true supercar that would go against European brands like Ferrari, Lamborghini, Porsche, and Lotus. This wasn't going to be an easy job. Differently from Italy, it was a bit hard to find car experts for such a job in Japan. Of course, there had been some sports cars built by the major Japanese brands, like the 2000 GT and the Cosmo, but nothing that would compare with the modern supercars. First, in order to compete with the big guys, Dome had to come up with a striking design. And like most of the brands of the time, they decided to go with a wedge-shaped design. The wedge-shaped design was popularized mostly by Bertone, with cars like the Alfa Romeo Carabo, Lamborghini Countach, and Lancia Stratos Zero, which, besides sharing the name, Dome also shared a very similar design with Gandini's masterpiece. But most of the wedge-shaped cars look the same anyway. The development of Zero would take 3 years. This partly due to the fact that, like I said before, it was a bit hard to find guys that were specialized on this type of job. They would work for long hours, and some nights they would sleep on nearby hotels. Since the money and time was limited, Hayashi had to use parts from other Japanese cars, including here the powertrain. The engine was a Nissan L28E, which was the fuel-injected version of the standard 2.8-liter engine. This engine was used on the Datsun 280Z, Nissan Leopard, and on the Nissan Patrol. The straight-six engine produced 145 horsepower and 166 pound-foot of torque, and was connected to a 5-speed manual gearbox. These don't sound like the most impressive numbers out there, but you should keep in mind that some of the 911s of the time had the same power output, and the Countach only had 381 horsepower from its 4-liter V12 engine. The weight helped Zero a lot when it came Tuttle performance. The car only weighed 920 kilos, something that allowed it to reach a top speed of 220 km per hour and to accelerate from 0 to 100 in 7.7 seconds. So, no bad numbers at all. Finally, the car made its debut at 1978 Geneva Motor Show, and everyone loved the new supercar from the land of the rising sun. Would be impossible to come up with something more futuristic than the Dome at Zero. The wedge shape, the glass panels, the pop-up headlights, the silver paint and the graphics, the digital instruments. Zero was every child's dream. The buyers started to line up and they were placing their orders for the car. But before starting the production of the car, Dome had to pass the homologation test first. Sadly, homologation requirements were very strict in those days in Japan, so Zero could not enter production. Hayashi didn't give up, and he started looking for the answer somewhere else. And so he turned to US. He started building a second prototype, which would comply with American regulation. Like most of the imports, the Zero P2 looked much worse compared to the original car, since the car had received huge bumpers in order to comply with American crash regulation. Also, the pop-up headlights were changed, and the pop-up headlights on the original Zero looked much, much better. The car was shown at the Chicago and Los Angeles Motor Show, when again managed to attract huge crowds. But Hayashi knew that in order to get the name out there, he had to start racing. And no title is more prestigious than the 24 Hour of Le Mans. So all the work was focused to prepare the LM car. Dome had the privilege to have many racing engineers on his team, so they knew what they were doing. And by 1979, the Dome Zero RL was ready. RL standing for Racing Le Mans. The RL looked completely different compared to the road-going Zero. The center cockpit was slicker now, the pop-up headlights were replaced by normal ones, and the rear part featured a long tail. For the 1979 Le Mans, Dome prepared two cars, number 6 and number 7, with 7 being a speedster. Like many LM first-timers, Dome made a good debut on the qualification, placing on the 15th and 18th place. But like most of the first timers, bad luck struck on the racing day, when both cars had to retire with engine problems. Dome also entered on the 1980 and 1981 Le Mans, but the story was basically the same. So after failing on racing, Dome decided to end the Project Zero for good. It wouldn't have been for the homologation requirements, who knows what would have happened with Dome, and also with the Japanese car industry in general, if a Japanese mid-engine supercar would have succeeded since the 70s, this would have pushed the big guys to start building supercars. But sadly, this never happened. Dome continued building racing cars for all kinds of motorsport, and they would specialize on carbon fiber, becoming a leader in Japan. And in the late 80s, they would try the supercar idea again, this time with a Giotto Caspita, a mid-engine beauty powered by a F1 V10 engine, but due to the Japanese economical problems of the time, never made it into production. But that's a story for another time. So guys, thank you for watching. See you next time.